Well, just about a year ago, "We want Zion" was the chant outside Little John Coliseum. They were sure Zion Williamson was coming to Clemson until...
"I will be joining the Brotherhood at Duke University."
And as Zion hugged his mom and Duke fans celebrated, Clemson fans watched the announcement in disbelief. Zion Williamson from Spartanburg, about an hour from Clemson. He was coming to Durham instead, and it looks like he may have started a trend of sorts. He's not the only one that's come from Clemson to Durham, as it turns out. And tonight, for the first time since making that decision, number one Duke and Zion Williamson will take on Clemson. Hi again, everyone. Bob Wischusen here with Dickie V, Dick Vitale. Allison Williams will join us in just a moment. It's got to be some bitterness if you're a Clemson fan watching not only Zion Williamson wear blue instead of orange, but watching how dynamic this team is. This group of freshmen is unbelievable.
Tell you one thing. I spoke to Coach Brownell before the game, and he said to me, "Dick, the day you were there, they played Notre Dame the day we were there, they beat the Irish." He said, "We lost Grant and one of our star players got injured. And then we lose Zion." He said, "We won 1-for-3. 1-for-3 counts in baseball, not in basketball." Well, he's got to defend them today. And I think when you look at Duke, you think about, well, offensively and defensively, they're the only team in America in efficiency that are in the top five in both. And when you're in the top five on offense and defense, you got a great chance to win. And one of the key players, obviously, Zion, but don't forget the name Trey Jones. The pressure he puts on that ball, he gets right up in you, man, like I'm getting up in you. He puts a nose right on the belly, baby. He can flat out defend.
Now let's leave that to folks' imagination if we can. It's hard to imagine that a team would have an advantage in any way playing against Duke, as deep and as talented as they are. But Allison, if there is one advantage, at least for Clemson, they're not going to get rattled in this atmosphere.
That's true, Bob. And I'm sure Dick would be the first to tell you that age is just a number. But that number for these two teams shows you just how opposite they are. Of course, Duke has their four incredibly talented freshmen, three 18-year-olds in their starting lineup. Tonight, they'll play in their first ACC contest against an experienced Clemson team with three 23-year-olds, three graduate students. Coach Krzyzewski said it's a lot easier to be good and young than it is to be good and old. And that's the challenge that Clemson presents them. Coach Brownell said that he hopes his guys experience playing, not just basketball, but playing here in Cameron will help them. 2 years ago, they lost by just 2 to Duke, and he's hopeful that that experience will play a part tonight.
I'll tell you one thing, Allison. I'd rather be great and young than good and old. Give me greatness and young diaper dandies.
That's what Coach K has. The first game since December 20th when you and I watched them beat Texas Tech at Madison Square Garden. This is as long a layoff as Mike Krzyzewski has said he can remember his team having for the holidays.
Well, he set it up that way, Joe. He wanted a two-week break. They get acclimated academically here at Duke as well. He said it's been a good training period.
Let's see how they handle it and if there's any rust, as Clemson did get one game in after the Christmas holiday as they were able to take out Lipscomb.
Who, by the way, is a very good team. The only team to beat TCU.
And that showed a little rust for Cam Reddish as he missed everything from three.
He struggled at the end of last year, but he made a big three against Texas Tech and four big free throws down the stretch. They got to get him going.
Deep post position for Elijah Thomas. He's pinned by Javon Delorier.
You know, Thomas is certainly a very experienced player, solid on the interior. But the one thing people don't realize, you know, Duke leads the nation in block shots. There it is, that challenge on the interior. When you've got a team that's up there in block shots, in steals, I mean, that is lethal. And a team that can transition, if you turn the ball over, they're going the other way for a layup.
Williamson left alone. Comes up a little short.
Not going to make him do that. They're not going to guard him. They will not guard him on the perimeter. They'll say, "Prove to us, Zion, you can make that 18-foot shot."
Marquise Reed had his pocket picked. Delorier is able to rip it away from Reed. Reddish attacks. And Williamson follows.
That's Zion, baby. That's Zion. that Zion at his best. Are you serious? Up, up, and away. Oh, man. That creates momentum. It creates excitement. The fans go ballistic. Everybody jumps out of their seat. Look at the smiles on their faces. Here he goes. Somebody better block this dude out, man. Somebody better block him out. There he goes. Oh, up, up, and away. He's the elevator man. He's the elevator man, Robert.
He goes right to the penthouse, and he has to make sure his head doesn't hit the rim.
He'll be going to the penthouse after this year.
He'll buy
not,
about every
he's not
penthouse
going to the
available.
Outhouse. He's going to the penthouse.
Name the penthouse. He'll be able to afford it.
29 dunks are in this year. Season just basically starting.
Reed gives it up. Leaning in, scoring, plus the foul, Elijah Thomas. So nice. A chance for Clemson to take the lead.
Nice little two-man game by Clemson. Clemson, as Allison said so well, such a veteran basketball team. They got three losses, 11 wins. Here they are right now, a little two-man game. Nice little bounce pass to the inside, and Thomas knows how to finish. They got a good backcourt with Mitchell and certainly with Reed. They got a good backcourt.
Thomas, the transfer from Texas A&M. Shelton Mitchell and Marquise Reed both tested the NBA waters and then collectively as a backcourt decided to come back to Clemson to play one more year.
They got a number of transfers, man. They got fifth-year players.
Williamson double-teamed. Lost it.
2-on-1. You got to make the play. That's a great pass.
Shelton Mitchell gave it up and lost it.
You got to convert that. You got to convert that. Wide open.
Jones can't hit. Williamson follows again.
He's dynamite on the glass, man. 9 rebounds a game, 3 of them on the offensive glass. He just has that natural knack of getting to the rim, and he has to bounce off the floor.
Not often a team's going to play the number one team in basketball and then in football within 3 days, but that is the weekend that Clemson fans get to enjoy as Elijah Thomas is able to equal Zion. They've each got 4.
Well, you know, Thomas moving well without the ball. Nice little two-man game by Clemson 2 times in a row. If Duke has an Achilles heel, as Al McGuire would always say, he's making that perimeter shot. People are going to back off until they prove they can consistently make that shot.
Reddish off the curl. In and out. Would you zone them more often than teams are?
You know, I think I would. I know that. But don't trouble with the zone, man. You don't get blockout assignments. And that sometimes creates a nightmare without getting blocked out. Nobody blocks out anymore. I heard my guy Van Gundy, and I love him. Jeff is terrific. I was watching an NBA game, and he said, nobody blocks out. And I got up on my seat, and I screamed, you're right. Amen, amen. I've been screaming that for I don't know how many years.
Trey Jones, mid-range jumper, gives Duke the lead back.
I like Jones, man. He's just a guy who doesn't get a lot of notoriety, publicity. He's such a valuable contributor to this Duke's team.
Shelton Mitchell, 8 on the shot clock, creates some space, buries the triple. Nope, they say his foot was on the line. It's just a long 2.
I mean, you got to make shots to beat Duke because Duke's going to score. They're going to score their points. Texas Tech really played them tough. I think if you look at Chris Beard, he's a rising star in coaching.
Offensive foul. Reddish tried to clear some space, and he picks up his first.
Look at this right here. Look at where his eye. See his eyes? He's looking right at that belly button. He's looking at that belly button defensively. Yeah.
Welcome back to Cameron, and welcome back to the ACC on ESPN. Bob Bischusen, Dick Vitale, Allison Williams. The Saturday showcase sold out here at Cameron for the 446th. Consecutive game and a good start.
Tell you one thing, Williamson's got 5 rebounds already. He's cleaning the glass, man. They better put a guy on him, put a body, and 2 of them were offensive rebounds for dunks.
Clyde Trapp, fresh in off the bench, hits a 3, and that gives Clemson the lead.
Tell you one thing, that's really nice when you get a guy off the bench and he drills a 3. They survived 5. Can they survive another 5? You want to play the game in segments. Chris Beard said he did that with his club. Played the game in 10 4-minute segments. Maybe they're going to play right here 8 5-minute segments. Survive 5.
Traveling call.
Yes, turning the ball over is a no-no. But at least it's not a live ball turnover where they get a layup the other way, because Duke is phenomenal doing it. They got four guys that can really pass and handle the basketball.
Both teams go to the bench. Jack White comes on for the first time, along with Alex O'Connell and Marquise Bolden for Duke.
Jack
as
White.
Zion Williamson sits down for the first time.
Jack White played a big role in that win over Texas Tech.
And Marquise Reed gave way to Clyde Trapp, who hit the three. Bolden with seven to shoot, needs some help. R.J. Barrett, shot clock down to five. Sweet finger roll along the baseline. Won't go, Bolden with the foul, across the foul.
You get a guy like Bolden coming off the bench. You realize coming out of high school, he was wanted by everyone. He was a McDonald's All-American, a super talented player. Here's a guy, Marquise Bolden, really operating on the offensive boards. That's been the problem right here for Clemson, trying to keep Duke away from the offensive glass.
Cam Reddish back in as he replaces Alex O'Connell. And on that drive, R.J. Barrett was shaken up. It looked like he caught the left elbow of Elijah Thomas fighting for the rebound, but he stays in the game.
You know, Bolden was really recruited big time by Kentucky. It was down to Kentucky and Duke, Big Duke, and he's not really played to the unbelievable reputation that he had out of high school, but he's hung in there, and he's a valuable contributor on the Duke team. There he is right there with a deflection.
Jumped in the passing lane, but taking it right back is Elijah Thomas. He'll go to the goal with a floater.
Tell you what a game he's having. Really doing a great job. A little balance on that baseline.
White from the corner. Rattles on the three.
He's a kid that's a big contributor. He wasn't recruited by everybody. He wasn't told he's America's best, like him from Australia. But he was really special. I mean, the way he's gotten better and better and better. And that's what you like to see at a player. Improve. Get better and better.
Now Coach K called him the consummate role player and bench player. And he said always John Wooden taught him to celebrate those role players. And he wants a guy like White to be celebrated. As the shot clock is down to three, a pull-up from the free throw line comes short for Shelton Mitchell.
Well, he plays like he's been playing when we've had games. He's going to get celebrated because we're going to sing his praises.
Here he is again. Couldn't hit from the corner. Mitchell,
nice
underneath
pass
to Thomas. And he finishes with the left hand.
I tell you, Thomas having a field day on the inside. Nobody defend him. Nobody defended him. Nice pass by Mitchell. Good look, good vision. Nice two-man game between those two guys, Mitchell and nice pass inside.
Bolden lost it. Taken away, though, by Clyde Trapp.
Duke looks a little bit rusty. You know, not playing in 15 days. Not making excuses, but they're not rotating over defensively like they normally do, communicate. Takes a little time now to get back into the flow of things. Students aren't here today. A lot of fans obviously sold out again.
Five turnovers now for Clemson. Our first Super Tuesday doubleheader of the new year features a pair of the ACC's finest games on Tuesday night. Zion Williamson, number one Duke, taking on the Demon Deacons in Winston-Salem at 7 Eastern. And then number 15 North Carolina, number 18 NC State from Raleigh. A great ACC doubleheader. Live, of course, on the ESPN app, so you can watch it anywhere and on ESPN on Tuesday night.
You know, it's great. Our colleague Jay Billis on Instagram had a video of his son scoring his first basket at Wake Forest. You can see the proud father, man. I don't blame him. He's a preferred walk-on, and he got that deuce, and it was an athletic move. I'll tell you one thing. He looked a heck of a lot better than his father the way he reversed and made the layup. I mean, Jay was a typical role player. He blended in so well as a blender.
How long it's been since Duke played the 15 days off and maybe some rust showing from that. That's what Coach K talked about. He said it's the analogy of the good and bad of getting off the horse. The good thing was they worked really hard on defense, implemented some things that were good for the team, but he knew there was also a negative side to that extended layoff.
Well, let's see if they can shake that rust off. Zion Williamson back in the game, back at the free throw line, looking for another old-fashioned three-point play.
Tell you, talk about strong. You talk about physicality. You haven't seen many like him. Who, people ask me, who does he remind you of? What about, sir, man of rebound, Charles Barkley? Maybe the other day I heard Bill Walton say Larry Johnson. That was another name.
Williamson, you wondered. Wow. How does Zion Williamson get produced? What if maybe a couple of guys that somehow you remind reminds you of got together? Could Grandmama and Charles Barkley, if somehow they got together, produce Zion Williamson?
I'll tell you one thing, pretty good combination.
Those are two guys you mentioned.
I know. Sir Charles, I mentioned both guys, and I tell you, they both can play, those two guys. They were special, and this guy's special, really special. Wait till he works and becomes a better shooter. Plays so hard, great attitude. Players love him on the team. He and R.J. Barrett are the best of friends. You see him get over the top of that screen?
Shot clock under 10 for Clemson.
Turn it over.
And here comes White. Reddish just lost the handle. Fumbles it out of bounds.
He's struggling. You can see the
six
frustration.
Six turnovers for Duke.
You can see a little frustration on his face. You asked Coach K in our meeting about him, and he said, you know, he's got to be able to. He had a great week of practice. He's got to be a little more consistent, and he played really well at the end of the Texas Tech game.
He said he had his best 4 minutes of the season against Texas Tech, where not only did he hit a big three, but also hit four free throws that iced the game and had a steal. Foul on the floor is called on Reddish.
Yeah, he bumped him right there.
That's his second.
You can see he's thinking a lot on the floor rather than just reacting and playing. I think a little frustration building up in him, you know, questions himself, missing some shots. Key in making shots is taking quality shots. Teams that do well take quality shots.
He's the number three recruit in America, playing with the number one and two recruits in America in Zion and R.J. Barrett. You think that weighs on him at all, trying to blend in with those two other guys?
It probably does a little bit. You know, you want to play to their level as well. But he's rated right now in the top five most NBA drafts for the...
Thomas, shot clock at three. Has to force one up. Dumps
what
it down
pass.
Low to Scara, who beats the timer.
What a terrific pass.
The officials awarded Clemson the basket on the floor, but Mike Krzyzewski thought it might have been a shot clock violation. We'll see.
See him post up right down here now. Watch this. Post up inside, dumps it in, scores. No basket, I don't think. Do you?
It looked like it was still on Scara's hand when the clock went to zero.
That was mine, but we're way up here. I got one eye, so I got an excuse. You have no excuse. You got two eyes. I got one eye sitting way up here. Are you kidding?
Yep. As the clock goes to zero, it's clearly still in Scara's left hand.
Well, credit that to Coach K and his staff there, because they jumped at it. Come on, guys. You can see that down there.
So they take the basket away from Clemson.
Tough break.
And it stays 14-13.
Tough break because he made a great pass right there against Thomas. Look at today. Wow. Virginia put the hurt on Florida State. In fact, that score does not indicate the dominance of Virginia in that game. Look at Iowa State. Michigan State, good road win. He's a rising star in coaching. We're talking about Chris Holtman, what he's doing. And then Kentucky lost to Avery Johnson for the very first time. Avery gets a big win over Kentucky, the Wildcats. And Kentucky came in playing well. They were just beating North Carolina and Louisville.
Reed in the corner to Scara for three. Yes.
They're making shots count, and they're playing with purpose. They got a little rhythm to what they're doing. They're not intimidated. I gotta give credit to Allison. Talking about the maturity, the age factor.
Williamson she should be up. Forces one up and draws a foul.
Yeah, she's right on the money.
Someone on this crew has to be.
Yeah. Well, listen to this. It looks like they survived another five. Now we go to another five-minute segment. Clemson playing those five-minute segments, in my mind, survive five. I mean, it's not easy to survive here in this environment against this kind of talent. And my friends, this is talent.
both referenced 2 years ago here at Duke when they lost by two, the confidence they got from that game, but also the desire to beat Duke. These are two guys that chose to come back for a graduate year. They had graduated already. They could have gone on and played professionally. They wanted to come back to Clemson, and part of the reason was continuing the momentum they had last year and accomplishing a few things, one of which is beating Duke, which they've never done in their careers.
Drive by Reed. Just rolls off.
He did everything right except finish and score.
Barrett from the corner. Comes up way short. And Reed's got it. And he was pushed by Zion Williamson.
I'm going to tell you this right now. Shooting the perimeter shot is a concern for Duke. And another concern is the free throw line. They do not shoot really well as a team on a free throw line. And the two biggest guys that get to the free throw line, Williamson and certainly Barrett, are not strong free throw shooters.
And that's a bad foul for Williamson. That's his second, so he'll sit maybe for the rest of the first half. We'll see. He was in foul trouble off and on all the way through the Texas Tech game that we called at the Garden. That was a big factor in Tech staying in that game as long as they did.
Yeah, we saw him on the bench quite a bit. In fact, that prompted me to say, I think we got to go to college basketball. Look at this play right there.
Old school off-balance hook. 10 points in the first half for Elijah Thomas.
He's having a heck of a day. I think we got to go to six fouls. I really do.
For what purpose?
Well, I just think that we have six fouls. Oh, his dude with the turnover.
Stara picks up the foul. You just want the better players to stay on the floor for longer periods of the game?
If you're a fan, a lot of people pay money to come to the game. Do you want to see Zion Williamson sitting there next to the coach? I mean, come on.
Now, they tried that way back when in the Big East.
Did they?
And it was a lot of fouls.
No, just one more foul. I just think that, you know, you got the reference. It's only sport. What other sport the players get sent to the sideline? Give me another sport.
Because of penalties?
Yeah, because of a referee blowing a whistle.
Well, hockey.
Well,
sent to the penalty box if they blow the whistle.
Yeah, I guess so. But they come back. They come back on, though.
They do?
In basketball, you're disqualified, man. You're disqualified when you get to that five number.
I guess the answer might be just don't foul.
But you know, you got guys, human nature, making those calls. Question mark, charge, block.
Nine turnovers in the first half for Clemson, and yet they've got the one-point lead.
That's amazing. They average 14 turnovers a game.
R.J. Barrett knocks down his first field goal.
He's the guy that's the machine. He's been very quiet in this game. He can score in spurts in a variety of ways. R.J. Barrett is a sensational player. Either be one or two, Barrett or Williamson in the NBA draft. If there's somebody better than them, I'd like to see him.
Trap just a little too strong, and White was able to tap it to Bolden.
I think they're shooting the ball a little too quickly right now. When I look at Clemson, be a little more patient on offense.
Wide open.
No communication there. Wide open for the dunk. Can't give those kind of baskets. That gives them a little momentum. Good timeout.
Wants a timeout. Cameron is rocking as Duke has the lead back. All right, Kevin, thanks very much. Only a three-point game here. Duke's got the lead. And Marquise Reed, he's got the basketball. He hasn't scored as of yet. There is his first bucket. He scores over 20 a game for Clemson, and he's finally on the board.
Well, they need him to put points on the board. He's, as you say, their scorer, and he's going to step up. Trey Jones always got great vision, always looking for the open man.
Off balance, Barrett stripped away from Delorier, but it will stay with Duke. And how about the eyes of Trey Jones?
Well, you can see he's always thinking, head up all the time. See, great vision, knows where people are on the floor. He's thinking, and there he spots an open guy inside Bolden, and it's a jam, but it was all created because of the vision and the anticipation by the point guard. Great point guard play. I like this kid.
And now he draws the foul.
Guys, I talked talked to Trey about his game, and a lot of it he gets from playing with his older brother, Tyus, growing up. Look how similar their numbers are through the first 12 games of their career at Duke. You can see the assist just off by one advantage, Trey. He has just 13 turnovers. Tyus had 18. So many similarities in their game, how they see the court, and just their demeanor. Trey is so mature for his years, and he said it probably is from having two older brothers that he was constantly playing with. He said it just taught me the game at a different level, and being around them, I always had to act a little bit older, and it really shows on the court.
Tell you one thing, I don't think Duke had a tough time recruiting this guy. I think they had a little advantage right there. I'm sure Richard Pitino would like to keep him in Minnesota. By the way, Richard doing a good job with that Minnesota Golden Gopher team, had a good win over Wisconsin.
Well, there was the story that when they went to recruit Tyus, Trey was 13 years old. Trey took Coach K and the coaches on a tour of the house, went into Trey's bedroom, and there were Duke posters all over the walls.
Oh, wow.
So they knew they had him locked up as soon as they got Tyus. Nice off-balance flip by Shelton Mitchell, and we are tied for the fifth time here in the first half.
Well, if Clemson's going to survive, it's going to be the backcourt has to do the job and create opportunities inside for Thomas. Mitchell and Reed, they're experienced players, as Allison indicated.
Oh, nice. Gives it up to Delorier, but Delorier couldn't handle the pass.
He had the right idea, but he should have dropped a little bounce pass.
Monday on ESPN, the college football playoff national championship game presented by AT&T. We'll be at Levi's Stadium in Santa Clara. The Tide and the Tigers, round number four. Number one, Alabama. Number two, Clemson. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Also streaming live on the ESPN app, so you can watch anywhere. Here's one thing Alabama and Duke have in common, at least this weekend. They both want to take out Clemson.
I'll tell you one thing. I was at the Clemson game against Notre Dame. Nice look inside. They get open looks on the interior. I will tell you this from a fan standpoint. Alabama 27, Tua. And the young kid, Trevor, 31. Clemson celebrates and wins the national title. And we're honoring Dabo Sweeney at my Dick Vitale Gala this year.
Sims called for a foul as he pushed Bolden in the back.
You know, you look at Clemson's resume, Bob, you mentioned it earlier. They're 10-3. You know, no real signature win. I mean, they beat Georgia, South Carolina, but they beat Radford and Lipscomb. Now, people are saying, well, who's Radford? Who's Lipscomb? Oh, really? Ask Notre Dame in Texas about Radford. And what about Lipscomb? Just ask J.B. Dixon in TCU.
Coach K puts Zion Williamson back in with the two fouls, and he scores.
They survive now another 5 minutes. As 3 5-minute segments, they've been able to survive five. Can they survive another five?
Shelton Mitchell tied up. Bolden taps it to Trey Jones.
Too many turnovers, man. Uh-oh. And he shoot the three. And again, turnover to points. Defense to offense. That's a trademark that is Duke basketball team, and it's been that way at Duke for many, many a year. You think about the great suffocating point guards defensively they've had. Yes, you think about it. Tommy Amaka, Rojo, Bobby Hurley.
Great drive by Clyde Trapp.
Don't forget Chris Duhon.
Well, Coach K made a good point. Said that they could have their third national defensive player of the year under 6 feet tall.
Incredible.
If Trey Jones is able to win the award, although they officially list him at 6'2", not sure if that is his, you know, barefoot height, but Tommy Amaker and Wojo both won that award as point guards.
And both coaches that, using that cerebral, that basketball intelligence they possess, coaching on a collegiate level, doing a good job. Tommy's down there at Harvard, and you got Wojo with Marquette, who, by the way, I thought they were going to be the class of the Big East the way they were playing until they ran into the Red Storm by 20. They were so impressive. They had John McEnroe jumping out of his seats. Louis Carnesecca was there, one of my idols, and he's 90 and he's still out there.
St. John survived today in overtime on the road against Georgetown in maybe the best old-time Big East rivalry there is.
Mullen and Ewing, what a great duo. And I'll tell you, both doing a heck of a job. Mullen now with St. John's, and Ewing has done a incredible job bringing back excitement to the Hoya campus.
Cheap reach-in foul on Cam Reddish. That's his third.
He's struggling. I'm telling you right now, mentally observing from up here, he is thinking and thinking rather than just reacting. He's looking at the brain trust of Duke to the right, John Shire. He certainly was a heck of a player here, made big shots during his time, and now doing a job coaching.
So Alex O'Connell's going to get major minutes, as you'd have to think Reddish is done for the rest of the first half. John Newman with the left hand, rolls it off the rim. A scramble for it, and getting it back and drawing a foul is Jaben White.
Tell you one thing, they're attacking the basket on Duke. They're not fearing their ability to block shots. They are really attacking off the bounds, taking the ball, drive, trying to drive and dish the rock. Loaded about dish it right there, the wide open guy. Dropped a little bounce pass. That's vision. That's knowing where people are.
RJ Barrett thought he was fouled on the reach-in. Instead, he picks up his first.
You know, I mentioned Louis quite a second. I want to say this. Happy birthday, Luigi. Happy birthday, Louis. He's 94 today. God bless you, Louis. Go eat nice. Send me the bill. Have some nice rigatoni, marinara, some meatballs. Go out there, Louis. Celebrate and send me the bill.
My birthday's in October.
Send me
the
bill.
Just want to make a mental note for next year.
You're not being 94, I can tell you that.
If I get to 94, he'll send you the bill.
I don't think I'll be around. I'll be long, long gone. Important for Clemson now to finish strong this half. Can't let Duke go to a double-digit lead.
White, another three ball. And he's got his third here in the first half.
How big has he been off the bench? He's had three big threes. I mean, you look at a six-point lead right there. He has created it. Get a little sloppy now. Bad shot. You don't want them to blow up this lead now. Double digits.
Backdoor cut. Jones. Just a little too strong.
Got the shot they wanted. A little six-footer.
White was left alone. Can't hit it.
Taking some bad shots now when you look at Clemson. Fourth shot right there. Defense right up in your face. You got to take quality shots.
Barrett floats one to Bolden. And he's able to finish.
Largest lead in the game. But think about this. The bench. We talk Zion. We talk RJ. It's been Bolden and White. Bolden and White have been difference makers off the pound.
He got fouled. A reach-in that will put Marquise Reed at the line. The largest lead for Duke. It is up to eight, and it is Jack White. Three triples off the bench to extend the lead.
There's Jack White, baby. Nothing but nylon. Oh, can he shoot the rock, baby? And Mr. Bolden says, I'm going to help my buddy out. Yes, Duke's bench, a difference maker.
Bob, we'll see you at the half.
All right, Kevin, thanks very much. And as those guys were saying, it has been the bench. It has been Jack White keying this 16-point effort off the pine for Duke.
Well, I agree with Seth and those guys. Certainly, no question about their bench has been a difference maker here. Very important now, last 2:53 for Clemson. They got to really tighten up defensively. They really control Barrett in this game.
Bolden one-on-one in the post. Well defended. And a nice wall off by Amir Sims.
They're going to show some patience now offensively and get some quality shots. Oh, they want to. Dude, it's better spacing. Need better spacing right there, Bob.
It'll stay with Clemson.
Brad Brownell not happy there on that sideline with that possession.
And we know the teams for the sixth straight year. Our megacast will have you covered from every platform, TV, radio, and digital. So many ways to watch and listen to the biggest game of the year. Alabama, Clemson, Monday, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Every production also available on the ESPN app. So turn on anything that has ESPN attached to it on Monday night. You get a different take on the national championship game as Reed tries a three. That's a big shot for the Tigers.
Well, they expect big shots out of him, and Reed responds. Definitely a big shot. They were down eight, getting a little bit in jeopardy, and been able to survive the first three fives. Chris Fowler and Herbie will do a great job in that game. They've done a great job all year.
Holden with the left hand. That's no good.
didn't have the touch right there. That was Brick City. Good effort. That was inside, a good post position.
Shelton Mitchell gets a step but misses the layup and takes a funny hop after he missed, came up a bit lame. Now he finally gets back on defense.
That's a second great drive he's made, but he's come up empty in both.
Rainbow jumper not there for Barrett, but the follow is for O'Connell.
Can't allow those easy baskets. And that's one area we talked about it earlier. They don't block out. But not only them, nobody blocks out. You got to block out. It's a simple fundamental.
I want 8 offensive rebounds for Duke. They're killing them with these follows.
Yeah, there it is. Nobody puts a body on it. Come on, Seth, come out here and teach a little bit how to block out. What's, I mean, I don't understand this. You got to block out. That'll drive me nuts as a coach. Make me lose my hair.
Great backdoor cut. And Clyde Trapp gets to hang from the rim. He's got 7 here in the first half.
Good athlete, Trapp. Made a big 3 earlier. Nice backdoor cut. Good spacing. Brad Brunell's an excellent coach.
Barrett swoops in and scores.
Big time talent right there. Been quiet, that contained him. Have done a great job containing him. He's a driving, slashing scorer.
Sims goes to the goal, tries to throw it down, and is denied by White. Trey Jones back the other way. He goes behind the back to DeLorean.
Great vision, man. What a player he is. He's a winner. He knows how to play, Mr. Jones. Mr. Jones knows how to play. Great vision, finds the open guy.
Marquise Reed walked the ball up, lost track of the time, and Roger Ayers said, you didn't get across the timeline in 10.
Unbelievable. Here comes the block. They lead the nation to block shots. It becomes contagious, and off they go. There's the great timing on the block shot, and Mr. Jones knows what to do with it. He took the rock and dropped it off. Well, you think about Duke, they've had some great wins this year. I just looking it up here. Kentucky, Texas Tech, Auburn, Indiana. I mean, they've had some quality W's.
Shot clock and game clock, maybe less than a second differential. So Duke can just about hold for the final shot of the first half. Dick, they have led by as many as 8, up by 7 now with 15 to go.
Well, up 7. If you Clemson, you got to have a little confidence going into the halftime. So, look, we played them tough. They're number 1 in the nation. We've really played them and battled them.
Reddish throws it in the backcourt, so it's a Duke turnover. So Clemson will get the final shot of the half. 9 first half turnovers now for Duke.
I'll tell you this, the first 4 minutes and a half, we talk about this often, and it's really no bigger than what's going to happen here. The first 4 minutes after this half are going to be vital to Clemson.
Well, you talked over and over again about having to win these 5-minute segments. Now Clemson has put themselves in a spot where they can't just survive a 5-minute segment at some point. They're going to have to win one.
Absolutely.
As Sims can't hit before the buzzer.
Plus, I'll tell you one thing, though, with Coach Brownell, he didn't come here for any moral victories. He didn't want to hear about we played him tough. We came here to win.
Clemson looking for their first win at Duke since 1995. And they are now going to have a 7-point hole to dig out of in the second half. It's
really dominating.
12 second chance points for Duke off of 8 offensive rebounds. Clemson, no second chance points. That and the bench scoring, the biggest factors in the first half.
You know, Bob, I'm going to tell you this. The first 4 minutes of this half is going to be vital. It's going to either be blowout city for Duke or we're going to have a basketball game. So it's really important right here that Clemson does a job executing.
Barrett throws one to DeLaurier. Extra pass to White, looking for another triple.
Wow. What a contributor he has become. Really, he was a guy really getting minimum minutes last year. He kept working and working and working. Great theory out there for you young kids.
Reed left his feet, lost the ball. Here comes Trey Jones. White. Crowd wanted the heat check. Instead, it's Barrett. And he
went. Oh, wow. Wow. This is not what you wanted if you're Brad Brownell. And the Clemson Tigers, away they go, showing why they're number 1, according to Kemp Pomeroy, in terms of offensive efficiency.
Foul on the floor called on DeLaurier.
guys, I spoke with associate head coach for Duke, John Shire, and he said the contributions of his bench were just huge in that first half. We're seeing it continue already here in the second. Jack White with his defense, his ability to hit those threes, and he's getting the start here because Cam Reddish has the three fouls. He said defensively, guys, they got to make sure they're staying in front of Clemson. They've done a good job against their press trying to spread them out and drive, so they got to stay in front of guys and make sure they're always keeping an eye on Marquise Reed.
They're not able to stay in front of Thomas here, but he missed the left-handed layup opportunity.
That's the first one he's missed today. How quickly it went to 13.
Zion Williamson with the left hand.
Are you kidding? Are you serious? Did you see that agility, that mobility? There's no doubt in my mind he would be my first pick in the draft. I really believe it. You can tell me about all these other guys and what box office bonanza wherever he goes. And he's going to get better and better because he works. He's working hard and trying to become a better shooter for the perimeter. People told me today at the shoot around, he was there the last time, but he left and he stayed there and he was shooting and shooting from 16, 17 feet.
Mitchell, contested shot, missed everything. Here comes Trey Jones.
Skate.
Spin move by Williamson, and he draws a foul.
That what amazes me, Bob, is quick, his footwork. His footwork, his agility, his mobility, his hostility, and he's not got fragility.
Have any more agilities in there?
Is there such a word? I don't know, man. I shock myself sometimes. Is there such a word? Come on, you're a very bright, intellectual guy. Fragility, is there such a word?
That exists. It I'm not sure if that's what you said, but yes, that exists. Williamson was a point guard through junior high school.
Wow.
And then he grew into the monster that he has become, where now he could be the definition of a power forward, but he is so comfortable handling the basketball.
And that's an area he wants to work and improve on. He wants to get that up into the high 70s, not in the 60s, not a free throw line.
A 10-zip run right out of the locker room for Duke stretches the lead to 17.
I told you the first 4 minutes are vital.
Well, it was the first vital. 2 minutes.
Wow. We saw Duke with their ability to spurt. Look at this. Starting to get really away here.
Shelton Mitchell can't hit. Offensive rebound, Thomas. Taken away by Zion Williamson.
He wants to handle that rock, baby, and he can handle it. He's got a great handle. Trying to set a little one-on-one move here.
Leans in, scores again.
Look at the way he hangs in the air. I mean, you can't teach that.
Scara tries to go coast to coast. Can't hit it. And then an offensive foul called. And it looks like that'll be Thomas on the offensive glass.
Starting to get a little bit ugly out here. Starting to get a little bit ugly. I think this Michael Jordan kind of hang time by this guy. Yeah, unbelievable.
Duke blitzes Clemson right out of the locker room. Just over 3 minutes gone by in the second half, and the Blue Devils in control.
He's happy today with that big win, unbelievable, over Kentucky. And Dabo Sweeney, we want all the Clemson fans to come out there for Dabo, raising money for kids. We hope to go over $4 million this year to get close to $30 million since we started the gala. There's a little jump shot right there. Hey, I want to go right now to Allison to find out what Dabo said about Zion.
Yeah, Dick, it wasn't just the Clemson basketball team that would have loved to have Zion Williamson. Here's what Dabo Sweeney said about him as a football player. He said, oh, my goodness, you could throw him over there at offensive tackle. If you had a DN, you couldn't stop. Then you could put him over at defensive end, and you could tell him the quarterback is the basketball goal, will go and dunk. He said then you could throw him at safety. He's athletic enough to hawk the ball. Can you imagine? He would be unbelievable. And I asked Zion, he did play some football growing up. He said if he still played, he'd probably be a tight end or a wide receiver. But guys, his high school didn't have football, so he stopped playing, but that didn't stop a few schools from still offering him a football scholarship.
Tell you what, he was smart. Get away from the helmet and his shoulder pads, and he went to basketball because his cash register, I'll tell you this right, next year, he's going to ding-a-ding-ding, ding-ding-ding. it's going to go off like you can't believe in terms of endorsements. He's a great kid, great personality as well.
Scara hits a three. Well, his cash register would go off no matter what sport he picked. If he wanted to be an NFL tight end, with that athleticism, as smooth of an athlete as he is, he could follow in the footsteps of an Antonio Gates or someone like that and go to the NFL and be a tight end, no question.
Gonzalez is up for the Hall of Fame. He's played at California.
Absolutely.
Played basketball.
Here's the three from Williamson, and he might want that one back.
Yeah, that's the area he's got to work on. He's going to really have to work on his perimeter shot, because obviously when he gets the NBA, he's going to be dealing with a lot of size on the inside. People strong, physical, big as well. So he's got to be able to step out a little and make some shots.
It was Duke by 7 at halftime, and they have opened up a 54-36 lead to start off the second half.
And let me just tell you this, too, as we watch here the shot. See right here, he shot, but he never got his body into this. Didn't get his legs into it. But he'll work on it. I'm telling you right now, he'll be a much better shooter because he's got a great mental attitude. He wants to be better. Hey, people, if you want more.
Back here at Cameron, Bob Wischusa, Dick Vitale, and Allison Williams. Duke is in control against Clemson. Game that they led by 7 at halftime, and now they've opened up the 54-36 lead here in the second half.
You know, very competitive first half. Clemson played them really tough. They were tenacious. But the second half start here by Duke has been demonstrating their explosiveness.
Nice swoop to the goal by Amir Sims, but another missed layup for Clemson. Sims thought about a three.
Sims did a great job beating Williamson off the bounce, but then didn't convert.
Got to be at least 5 times that Clemson has done a good job driving the ball to the goal.
And not scoring.
That floater is there for Reed. But, boy, you can't miss your layups when you're playing Duke, and they've missed at least 5.
Yeah, no question about it. They made great drives and attack. They're going to a zone right now. They normally play straight man-to-man. They're zoning right now, trying to match up when they see Williamson. Oh, nice fake.
White back to Barrett. In and out, and a rebound to Amir Sims.
So one thing, White's PG is going to go up. He's going to get more and more playing time. You know, people often ask me, you know, is this really the best Duke team? I've liked a few other teams a little better. I certainly love the combination of Leitner, Hurley, and Hill. That group was special.
That three's no good, and Williamson is fouled by Reed. What do you think is a close comparison between this Duke team and maybe some great Duke teams of the past?
Well, you think about in the era of the 2000s now, 2001, I love that team. Their rotation had 5 guys that made it to the NBA. 3 who were drafted in the top 6. You think about Shane Battier, was great on, off the court, great defensive player, just terrific. And then you think about our own, you know, Jay Williams, he was unbelievably talented and second in the draft. You think about Mike Dunleavy, sharp shooting. You factor in Carlos Boozer and Chris Duarte. I'll take that team. I'll take that team. But I'll give you this team, and I love these guys. I mean, what a combination. Barrett is from out of Canada.
Well, you hate to say it. I mean, Dick, this is the standard that you are held to if you come to play for Mike Krzyzewski. But if you want to be remembered as a great Duke team of all time, you have to win the national championship.
You got to win. You got to win it all. It's not getting to the Final Four. It's not getting to the tournament. I mean, their standard is totally different. It's one thing. Win it all.
And that 9-point advantage that Duke had in that first 5 minutes of the second half has blown this game open. Shot clock down to 1. Did Shelton Mitchell beat the buzzer? He did not.
No, he did not beat it. No question. It's a second shot clock violation. Our goal is simply to win the national championships. That's one of the problems when you think about the elite schools. That's basically the theory also when you think of Kentucky, North Carolina. I mean, those clubs just don't play to get to the Final Four. They play to win it all.
Sweet left-handed finish by Trey Jones.
Trey Jones can play. And that's one of the problems out of UCLA. When they've had so many coaches. They've had about 10 coaches since John Wooden was there, because the standard the people have is so, so high. You think about, you know, Ben Hollinger's 3 times to the Final Four, 3 consecutive years. Our guy Steve Lavin, who worked with us years ago, 5 out of 7 years to the Sweet 16. This time, Steve Wolford went 3 out of 5 years to the Sweet 16.
Reddish with the steal and the finish.
That's Reddish's athleticism right there. He's got great handle, bounce, very high. We have not seen the real Cam Reddish here tonight. But think about that. That's why that job at UCLA, you have to have a guy that really can captivate the people big time, especially dealing with the Lakers, the Dodgers, the movie stars. You need someone that has presence and star stature, not just X and O guys. And I agree with Dan Dockage. I agree with Seth Greenberg. Nobody wants to agree with me when I say it, and that's their prerogative. That's why Rick Pitino becomes a major, major name in terms of for that job. I really believe it, and nobody's proved to me yet. We've had assumptions. Nobody's proven yet, beyond a doubt, that he was involved in anything knowing about what happened with the situation, with the dorm, with the assistant coach, and all that. So give me all that nonsense. Prove it to me. And I'm telling you now, Rick Pitino would be an instant big-time winner at UCLA.
Well, next year we're going to prove to you that 15 universities and one network is going to work, because it's ESPN and the ACC bringing you the ACC Network in August. Visit GetACCN.com
wow.
to learn more.
Wow. That is Duke team. They're going to do a little better on the free throw line. I'll tell you one thing. They really are so explosive. What makes them special is that people do not give enough attention and recognition for their incredible ability to defend. And it starts right there with number three. With
and the push, there it is. Gets the takeaway.
Okay. Are you serious? Slam jam, bam! Get him ready for the NBA dunking contest. Bring on Dominique Wilkins. Bring on all the great ones from years ago. Oh, they love it. Look at them jumping with joy. They got their treat for the night here.
Out of bounds. And it belongs to Duke.
His potential is scary. You can't teach what he possesses. The physicality, the toughness, the agility, the great footwork, the handle. Oh, look at this here. Oh, his teammates are jumping with joy. They see that in practice. Are you serious what we just watched? Are you serious? Oh, man. I've been sitting here 40 years. I haven't seen something like that in my 40 years. I tell you, he's a unique. He's not the best player I've ever seen, but he's certainly the most unique and different player that I've ever seen.
Reddish. Long rebound out to Shelton Mitchell. Down the lane, tripped up. And a dangerous play as Reddish ended up in the front row.
It's amazing how this game got away from Clemson. They had a good game plan. Brad Brownell had them ready to play. So competitive. A little bit at the end of the half really hurt them.
Now we've got the Dick Vitale, Mount Rushmore of college basketball book to talk about. Gypsy Dude Dunkaroos, the
wow.
Mount Rushmore of dunkers. Where would that guy fit in? We'll talk about that when we come back. Mount Rushmores of college basketball. The Dipsy Dude Dunkaroo Final Four. Where would Zion Williamson fit in with this group?
Well, Dominique's certainly special. You saw Darryl Griffith, Dr. Dunk. You saw Mr. Oh, sent it in Jerome, Sibley Raftery. Look at those guys right there now.
Who are you taking off?
Well, let me tell you, one of them would have to go. One of them would have to go, and I'm going to tell you who'd go. And I loved it, but he'd have to go. If I do my 50-year book, I'll guarantee Zion's going to be on here, and the guy's going to have to go. Sorry, send it in, Jerome, because I'll tell you this, Drexler's not going, and neither is Dominique, and neither is, you only think about great dunkers. I mean, how could you not think about certainly Dominique and Dr. Dunk Griffin? He was special as well, and Drexler.
We have a few other guys for you to think about that you didn't put up
oh,
on your
yeah, these guys,
How about
yeah.
Spud Webb, who won the NBA dunk contest at 5 foot nothing, basically. Harold Miner was baby Michael. Then you have Michael and Vince Carter. You mentioned Grandmama on the first half.
Well, Michael, you know, first of all, is one of my four best players. And we did four Mount Rushmores. Dick Weissman does a great job. Anybody would like the book. And the thing I love about the fact with the book, every dollar I would make, and I got a big check that's going to go right now to the V Foundation. So I want to thank many of you for buying it. But if you want an autographed copy of my book, The Mount Rushmores of Basketball, for coaches, as Mike Krzyzewski's one, just go to DickVitaleOnline.com. You get an autographed copy, and every dollar I would make is going to the V Foundation for pediatric cancer. Nothing worse than watching kids. We just had the recent passing of Tyler Trent, and there were some great articles. Greg Doyle did a great one. Our own Wojo did a phenomenal job writing about him, how he captivated the nation. And we have, with the V Foundation, the Tyler Trent Fund. If anybody would like to donate to Tyler's fund, just go to jimmyv.org/Tyler Trent. That's all you got to do. jimmyv.org/Tyler Trent.
That's what the gala's all about as well.
It's all about kids, man. There's nothing worse than seeing kids have to battle that disease. It breaks my heart.
Well, this has been a battle uphill the whole way in the second half for Clemson as Amir Sims is fouled on the drive.
Well, I got to disagree with you, Robert, and I love you, buddy. It's not really been a battle. It's been all Duke in the second half. Domination. Is there such a word as domination?
Yes.
Oh,
that's
is?
Fine.
I gotta make sure I gotta check with you guys.
You're getting the triple word scores. You're lining them all up in the second half.
Because I'm usually a one syllable guy. I get these other multiple syllables, it gets a little scary. I tell you, life in the ACC. The one thing we're gonna see now, which is great, the cupcakes are all tucked away. And now we're gonna see who's real and who's fake.
Rips away the rebound.
Boy, is he earning playing time.
Hit ahead to DeLorean. Allows the push.
He's another good player off the bench. Was a big-time high school star. His team looks dominating. I don't think the 15-day layoff for the second half has been any dilemma to them. Fresh. And away they go. Run, baby, run.
Run, baby, run. He'll go to the line.
RJ Barrett, he's a driver, slasher.
Well, that second semester has begun. Now, Duke had a few teams that they were able to dominate as they visited the Ivy League with Yale and Princeton before what was a quality win at the Garden against a good Texas Tech team. Now they start conference play, their first big road test. Really the first real big pure road test of the season will be there next Saturday when they go to Tallahassee and they take on a Florida State team that was non-competitive today in Charlottesville.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. They should have a little chip on their shoulder after that performance today, Florida State. So that game, they got a long win streak at home going for them as well. They got a home game before they play Duke against Miami. Had some great performances today. Certainly Alabama over Kentucky. Michigan State beating Ohio State. Nice three right there.
Marquise Reed knocks it down.
Well, he's got scoring ability. I like Reed. I like Mitchell. You can't really get a true indication and say, well, they can't play when you watch a team get dominated by Duke. Because Duke's going to make a lot of clubs look like they can't play.
Marquise Reed, one of only three players in the ACC, averaging 20 points and five or more rebounds per game.
I think Bolden and White have stepped up to really make Mike Krzyzewski feel golden tonight.
You know, because it rhymes.
Yeah.
That was good. Barrett. Bolden with the tip on.
Bolden having himself quite a night, man.
He's having quite a night. Only the second time this season for Marquise Bolden to hit double digits.
You know, Bob, you think about this. When you have the combination of great coaching, and I use the word great because he could go down as the greatest coach ever in basketball. I mean, you could talk on certainly John Wooden, what he did at UCLA is right there. But not only what he's done at a collegiate level, you got to factor in what he did with the Olympic team, the three gold medals that he won, brought back the pride of wearing that USA jersey that had gotten away. Let me say this. You put that combination of great coaching with great talent, the formula is very easy. It's a formula that equals success.
And he'll need that formula next Saturday as we take a look at an upcoming Sonic blockbuster. It'll be fun to be in Tallahassee because that's a game that they have circled since the schedule first came out when Duke goes to Florida State, 2 Eastern right here on ESPN.
You know, Gonzaga's going to get it better and better now that Tilly's back, and I think Gonzaga's a team you're going to watch in the postseason. The one thing about college basketball that is so special, it's not 4 out of 7. And in a one-game scenario in the NCAA tournament, Duke can be sent to the sideline. It's not Lock City.
Well, they've already lost a game, and that was something that Mike Krzyzewski coming out of Maui when they lost to Gonzaga, I think, wanted everyone to say, hey, let's take a step back and let's realize that it is a team full of freshmen. They still have to find their way.
I don't think anybody beat them 4 out of 7. It was 4 out of 7 at collegiate level, nobody beats them.
I think that's probably true.
Well, I'm having a great day here today because my grandsons are with me. Ryan Spores, a very good lacrosse player. My grandson Jake's here, an outstanding tennis player. His brother's under the weather, Connor at home. And I wish I had them all here. My granddaughter Sydney, my granddaughter Ava. Nothing like having grandchildren, Robert. They just bring a smile to your face. Beautiful. I've been blessed. They're beautiful kids academically and in their tennis pursuits and lacrosse pursuits. I'm a little biased.
Right now, I've got teenagers. I'm just trying to survive.
That's a tough age, yeah. That's a tough age.
Thanks for your empathy. I appreciate it.
Matt, you've done a great job, you and your wife. Love, man. It's only one definition of having a great family. It's the love, love, and love. Our nation needs more love. We need love above all people, black people, white people, rich people, poor people, everybody hugging one another. I got to get a soapbox right now because this game is over, man. This baby, tuck it in the book. As 8 minutes to go, tuck it away.
With the left hand, unable to finish with Zamir Sims.
People want to know why I'm laughing. I'm laughing because my producer came out screaming right here. You're going to be running for politics right now. You're getting your political speech ready. No, I want no involvement in that game.
Sims for three. Comes up short. Here's RJ Barrett.
I got to be answered. I got to be very honest. Games like this make you go wacky. This is no way.
The follow is there for Shelton Mitchell.
Well, I'm glad Shelton Mitchell stayed with it. You know, you think about what we talked about. Duke leads the nation block shots. Their scoring transition's unreal. The only area is shooting the ball. Steve Wiseman did a heck of a column today all about that in the News Observer here in Raleigh.
RJ Barrett runs down his own miss.
He wants to drive, man. He's a slasher. He wants to drive. He wants to beat you.
Step back three.
That's an area he's got to work on, too. He's a suspect long-range shooter.
Mitchell leans in, scores, plus the foul.
Nice play by Mitchell.
He'll have a chance for an old-fashioned three-point play.
You know, when you got Mitchell, Reed, and Thomas, you got a nice little trifecta there. Those three guys are going to win their share of games. 10-3 right now, lost to three good teams.
You said it's all about love. I think Mike Krzyzewski loved this.
Oh, fans did. Wow. Some NBA scouts just jumped out of their seats when they saw that, baby. I'm going to tell you, box office bonanza, Zion.
We are back here at Cameron. Free throws for Clemson, but they trail by 23 with 7:10 to go. Bob Schusen here with Dick Vitale and Allison Williams. And it has been lopsided here in the second half. A game that was close up until we had about 3 minutes to go in the first half. Duke led by 7 at halftime as O'Connell tries a three and rims it out. And the Blue Devils came out, and O'Connell gets a steal and draws a foul. And Duke blitzed Clemson in the first 2 minutes of the second half, and they have just widened the lead as we've continued.
Well, they just went to the zone right there in that possession. They played the zone here a couple of possessions in the game. If you're Coach Brownell now, what you're going to do simply, you have to do, is take something positive from this. And what you take positive is, as you sit with your team tomorrow or you meet with them on Monday, you sit there and you talk to them a little bit about the first half, how they were so competitive and how they were right there taking quality shots and all got away against a talented team. And you got to make them feel good about some things that they did in this game and point out, that's the number one team in the country. And they showed in the second half why they are the number one team in the country.
And this Clemson team losing lopsided here at Duke, but later on this season on their home schedule, they've got Virginia. They've got Virginia Tech, they've got Florida State, they've got North Carolina, all coming to take them on at Little John. So those are big-time ranked opponents that they're going to be playing at home as missing point-blank range Antonio Brankovic.
Brankovic was right there for that score.
three rims out for Sims.
Tell you one thing, this Duke team, I talk about getting love, man. They're going to get a lot of love from their fans, from the Cameron Crazies. All I need is a little love. The Beatles, huh? All I need is some love, baby.
All you need is love? Were they talking about you in that song? I didn't know you. The you was Dick Vitale. Learn something new every day. Here comes Marquise Reed. Cruise in for two for Elijah Thomas.
Well, that Duke got a little sloppy in defensive transition. Coach K standing up, and he'll let him know about that, too.
Let's go!
I mean, you talked to him before a game. I wanted to say to him today, when you and I were there with him, I was going to come close to say, Coach, has anybody told you that you're in a hole, folks? See, that's big.
He starts, Williamson hitting a three.
He starts making those kind of shots. His stock goes up, up, and up. I don't know how much more it can go up. But, you know, Coach K, to show you why he's such a winner, we're with him before the game, and you would think this guy never won a game. He's sitting there talking about intensity, talking about the excitement of coaching in a big game. I mean, unreal. You know what it's like to coach after 15 days of being out? Mike, you won gold medals. You stood on the podium there with the greatest players in the world, the LeBron James and those people.
Hits the bottom for Hunter Tyson. That's his first bucket. But you don't get to be Mike Krzyzewski unless that drive never goes away.
Absolutely.
Right? That's how you become a Hall of Famer.
All the great ones have it. You saw Saban when he went bananas on a sideline with Tua. See, when you're a winner, they say that's great motivation. If he was losing, they would say he's being abusive. He's being abusive. I can imagine if that was when Coach Knight was coaching. If he threw the clipboard down, screamed, got in the kid's face, a couple of choice words.
Couple
of choice words
were
given. Wow.
Well, tonight on SportsCenter, after Clemson Duke here on ESPN with Zubin Mehenti. An upset Saturday. Kansas and Kentucky both go down. How those upsets occurred, plus Duke's biggest concern. Well, doesn't seem like they have many concerns right now, but we'll hear from Coach K on SportsCenter and a SportsCenter conversation with Dabo as he gets set for Alabama on Monday night. SportsCenter after Clemson Duke here on ESPN and the ESPN app.
Two great coaches going to go out in that game. You think about Saban, probably the greatest coach of all time in college football. And Dabo Swinney is an unbelievable motivator. He does a great job. Look at that timing. Look at that timing and the agility. Getting back. Looked like a sure layup. And here comes Zion. Unbelievable. Dabo Swinney's a great motivator, has a great rapport with his players. He's a coach's dream, and a player's dream.
Williamson leans in, scores again. He is ashamed of that.
We are seeing the talents of this guy, and he's a multi-talents. I mean, it's amazing, people, when you think about a 285-pound player being that agile.
25 for Williamson as he is over 20 for the seventh time in 13 games.
I would love to see in his prime surround the rebound man, Charles Barkley, go head-to-head with Zion. What a combination that would be. Look at this here. Look at that block shot. Oh, get it out of here, says Zion. Get it out of here. And then what about this? Look at that mobility. Hang time. What a talent. He is so special.
ESPN's exclusive.
And putting on a show here tonight in Cameron, and there is such a performance to what he does on the court, and perhaps it's because he's been having people come to watch him play from a very young age when he was in AAU. Another show here on the defensive end with a big block. When he was in AAU in high school, people would be lined up outside the gym to watch him play, and there was this sense that he kind of had to give the people what they came for, which he's doing again here tonight. I talked to assistant coach Knight James about it, and he said because he was exposed to that at a young age, he plays so hard to make those people happy, but he's so competitive and he just wants to win that it's never in a selfish manner. He performs, but it benefits the team.
That was an awesome goaltend. But you can see, Allison, you're right. It doesn't matter how lopsided the score is. In this game, at least in terms of the final score, that's the only thing that's left to wonder about. He still plays with the same intensity that he played the first 2 minutes of the game with.
Yeah, it's great to get a kid like that, because sometimes kids, their heads get so big with the publicity and notoriety. But he has just handled it so beautifully. Coach K says it's amazing, the relationship. Because I asked him, is there any chance of maybe some envy, some of the kids seeing all this publicity he gets? None whatsoever. He said the players love him. He says his best friend is RJ. Byron, he's on the sideline right now.
Duke as a team has 7 double-doubles this season, and 6 of the 7 double-doubles belong to Zion Williamson.
Yep. Tell you one thing, he's going to be driving a lot. We're raffling off a beautiful, beautiful red Mercedes convertible 2019 to raise money for kids. Anybody would like to get a chance. We already sold out on the one car, and now we're working on the second one. They go so quick. It's only $100. It's a donation to the V Foundation. And bottom line is, you got a chance because there's only 1,500 chances. And it's a beautiful red Mercedes convertible. I mean, absolutely gorgeous. Just go if you want to get it. Go to jimmyv.org/VitalRaffle 2019. jimmyv.org/VitalRaffle 2019. Coach K does a great job as a member of our board of directors with the V Foundation. So does David Robinson, whose son plays for Duke. David Robinson's on our board as well. Got so many great board members. The only thing they care about is helping people battle cancer.
How much money do you think you'll be able to raise this year?
I'm hoping to raise, you know, I need people to help me, but my goal is high. I want to hit $30 million. We've raised $25.2 million thus far.
Wow.
Since I started, but I want to get to 30, so that means I need $4.8 million. I wish somebody out there would come with a big donation and just give us a big donation. It is really so special. But you see some of these kids. Hey, Bob, you know I speak all over the country motivationally. I've been with the Washington Speakers Bureau for 3 decades. The toughest speech I ever had to give. I had a family ask me to speak when their son died of brain cancer. And I've been to a couple of funerals. Watching a mom and dad. I mean, I love young people. I love people. And just to see that just tore my heart out. I'm obsessed with this. I'm obsessed with trying to help kids. You know it. You've been out to my gallery. Allison's been to the gallery. Kim Belton's been to the gallery. Our boss is here today. David Seisler comes to the gallery. And it's just really very special to me because it's heartbreaking. It's not losing a basketball game, man. We're not talking the flu. We're talking about people dying. And it just breaks your heart.
Where you at? I got you. Where you at?
83-62. Duke's got the lead with under 2 minutes to go. And if you were to look wide-angle lens at the ACC, where would you draw that line? You've got Duke. Certainly Carolina deserves to be in that conversation. Virginia might be the best team in the league before all is said and done. Virginia Tech is off to a great start. What are those games that we're going to have to watch this year in the ACC that are really going to determine the cream of the crop?
Well, you always got to talk about Duke and North Carolina, but obviously I think there's a little separation with Duke and Virginia. They do it in different ways. They do it with different style of plays, but they really know how to win it. Those matchups are going to be special, but Duke
and Carolina. Next Saturday, the game we've got, as non-competitive as Florida State was today at Virginia, they're still a top 10 team.
Absolutely.
That could be one of those barometer games.
Yeah, because right now, I don't know exactly, but I think Florida State's got 32 in a row at home. And I've been there before in a Duke game with Florida State where they beat them. Been there when they beat a great North Carolina team. Leonard Hammond will have them ready to play. They're very physical. But today, the execution of Virginia was unbelievable, especially early in the game. They moved the ball well. Their 3 perimeter players are outstanding. I mean, you got to like Guy and Jerome and Hunter. Those people know how to play, know how to win. They know how to win. They do it different ways, though, you know. But the bottom line is the result is usually the same, a W. So those games are going to be special, obviously. The ACC is always one of the great conferences. SEC is going to be so competitive this year. Tennessee, wow, did they put a hurt today on Georgia. I mean, Tennessee, Rick Barnes is close. People laughed at me when I had them three preseason in my poll, have number three in the country. I mean, that team is special. They're veterans. They know how to win.
They might be the best team in the country.
Might be. Kansas got really hurt today, big time. The 17, Iowa State. Big win for the Cyclones.
Iowa State's better than even the pollsters realize. They're starting to understand how good they are as Frankovich is able to score inside.
You know who's the star of that game? Shayok, who came and transferred from out of Virginia. Today, the star of stars, I think, today, was Shamori Ponds. He had 37 for St. John's in an overtime win. When you score 37 and your team needs every one of them to be able to survive, that's special.
Down to the final seconds, and Duke polishes off an 87-68 win over Clemson. Another double-double for Zion Williamson. He was the star for Mike Krzyzewski.
Hey, one thing, Mr. Brownell got a six-year extension of $15 million. That isn't all that bad. And he does a heck of a job, really, Clemson. He's a teacher, and he'll take the positives. But this was long, too. Zion was the Lion King, man. Zion was a king today. He was the king.
87-68 is the final. Coming up next, it is SportsCenter. Zion Williamson did it at both ends of the floor. For Allison Williams and Dick Vitale, I'm Bob Wischusen. So long from Durham.